Hello, my name is Keshwani.
That's K-E-S-H-W-A-N-I,
Keshwani. We are here because we want to prepare for the GRE. We have been solving GRE math problems out of this book here, the official guide to the revised GRE, the second edition. If you do not own this book already, purchase one immediately. You're going to need it. We have finished doing almost all the problems from this book. If there is any math problem that gives you trouble, you will find a solution to the problem from day number 251 through 400. From 251 through 400. This book happens to contain almost exactly the same problems and in almost all the cases in exactly the same page numbers as the ones that appeared in the first edition of the revised GRE. We are finished doing all the problems from this book. If you are interested in watching any of the original solutions to the problems, you will find the original solutions from day number 1 through 250. Right now, we are in the process of doing some quantitative comparison questions out of this book here, the 10th edition of the general GRE. Quantitative comparison questions. Quantitative comparison questions are very important. They are still a big part of the exam to get some extra practice because the other two books do not provide enough practice problems. So to get some extra additional practice, from day number 401, we started solving quantitative comparison questions from this book, and right now we are on page number 241. Please turn to it. Page number 241, problem number 6. As I always tell you at the beginning, or if sometimes I forget to remind you, but you must remember yourself, as soon as I finish setting up the problem, you must pause the video, do the problem yourself, and then compare your work against the work that we're going to do together. Do you understand? You will get more out of it that way. Don't wait for me to actually show you the solutions, because then by that time it's too late. So here's number 6. As soon as I finish setting it up, pause the video immediately. 78% of people have no problem with it. Here's what the problem says. Y over 2 versus X plus Y over 2. Go ahead and do what you have to do. Compare the two quantities. And when you have the answer, you can resume the video and then we'll compare the work. Do you understand? I'll give you 2 seconds to do just that, to pause and unpause. Here we go. We see 2 in the first column here at the bottom. We see 2 at the second column here in the bottom. Why don't we multiply both columns by 2? You multiply both columns by 2, the 2's are going to cancel out. Do you understand? Now, had it been a real exam, I would not have done what I just did in a babyish way, just like we just did. You want to multiply both columns by 2, well, this is simply what you do. That's it. You cross out the 2 from the bottom on each side. That's it. You're done. And we are left with y versus x plus y. I see a y here. Why don't we subtract y from both sides? Let's subtract y from both sides, and the y's are going to drop out. And we're left with 0 here, and we're left with x here. Again, had it been a real exam, I wouldn't do it in a babyish way like this. You want to subtract y from both sides, just subtract y from both sides. That's it. Cross out the y from both sides. It appears in both columns. Once you do that, you end up with 0 here versus x here. What can you say which quantity is bigger? 0 or x, or are they equal? Can you say anything at all about x? The answer is no. The problem provides us absolutely no information about x at all. Essentially, what's going on here is that I woke up to you and I tell you that I'm thinking of a number. I woke up to you and tell you that I'm thinking of a number. Can you tell me whether that number that I'm thinking of is less than, equal to, or more than 0? To which you would either slap me in the face and say, go away, you idiot, or you'll say, what the hell? You're wasting my time. You cannot tell, obviously. It's a question mark. How can I tell? X may be equal to 0, X may be less than 0, X may be more than 0. Who knows? X could be positive, X could be negative, X could be equal to 0. We do not know. The answer is D. Let's do number 7. Question number 7. Question number 7 is a geometry problem. We're given a picture here. Triangle. A perpendicular comes down straight at 90 degrees, which is why it's called perpendicular. I was being redundant. And then they show you another line here, which they're calling T. And they tell you that S point S here, S we are told is the midpoint. Midpoint is one word. S is the midpoint of PR. S is the midpoint. In other words, P to S equals S to R. S is the midpoint. And what we are being asked to compare, column A, column B, what we are being asked to compare is the length of QT, right here, length of QT versus QR. Pause the video and do it yourself, okay? So here we go. What we have to understand here is that even though we do not know much at all, they do not give us angle or anything, but they actually do give us quite a lot of information here. The fact that PS, we are told, the fact that we are told that S is the midpoint of PR, which means P to S is same as S to R, that tells us that this angle here, whatever this angle is, angle SQR is going to be a larger angle than the angle TQR, angle TQS. TQS. I hope you are able to see that this angle is a larger angle than this angle because of the fact that this distance here, is a bigger distance than the distance from T to S. It doesn't matter where the T falls. We do not know the exact location of Q to T because the picture in the exam, as you know, are not drawn to scale, so we do not know where exactly T is, how close it is to P or how close it is to S, but it doesn't matter where the T falls because regardless of where it falls between P and S, the distance from T to S will always be less than distance from P to S, which means this angle, TQS, angle TQS is always going to be less than the angle SQR. And since this is a larger angle, the side facing the larger angle is a larger side, S to R is always going to be more than T to S. S to R, but that's not what they want you to compare. They want you to compare Q to T, oh sorry, Q to T, of course, it's going to be shorter than Q to R because this is a longer side, so it's stretch out more. S to R, we know S to R is larger than T to S, and therefore this side, because it has to stretch out more, Q to R is always going to be more than Q to S. The answer is B. Answer is B. Because if I stand here, I'll just keep beating the dead horse. It's very straightforward. Number 8. Question number 8. In question number 8, we are told that a merchant made a profit of 61% of the people got it right. Merchant made a profit of 2.75 on something that cost him $12.25. So he bought it for $12.25, he bought it for $12.25, and he turned around and sold it at certain price where he ended up making a profit of $2.75. What they want us to compare is this. Column A, where we show his profit as a percentage of his cost versus column B, his profit as a percentage of his sale price. Again, I want you to pause the video, do the problem, and then resume the video. There is a reason for it. Do it yourself right now. Pause and unpause the video. I'll give you 5 seconds to pause the video, do the problem yourself, and then we'll compare the work, shall we? The reason I ask you to pause and unpause the video is not because this one is a particularly difficult problem. It's a very straightforward problem. The reason I ask you to do the problem yourself is because I want to see exactly how you go about doing it. Profit as a percentage of his cost, his profit is $2.75. As a percentage of his cost, we are told, is right here, $12.25. That's his profit as a percentage of the cost. Versus his profit, again, $2.75.
versus his sale price. How much is the sale price? Sale price is what it cost him to buy the item plus whatever profit he made. Obviously, that's his sale price. His sale price is equal to the cost plus the profit. My question to you is, what did you do next? What did you do next? Let's continue this from the top. If you actually sat there, if you actually sat there and wasted your time figuring it all out, if that's what you did, then you're still not getting the point. This question is called quantitative comparison, which is why we make a point of writing down the word computation and then crossing it out for emphasis. We're not being asked here to compute anything. We're simply being asked to compare the two things. Here we have 275 over 1225. Let's keep our conversation simple, to keep our argument more straightforward, let's think in whole numbers. Let's pretend that this is 3 over 12. So here we have 3 over 12 versus 3 over 15. What we have to understand is that the top is the same in both cases. The numerator, 275, is the same in both cases. Since the numerator is the same, whichever one contains the larger denominator is going to be smaller. Whichever one contains the larger denominator, that fraction is going to be smaller than the ones that has greater denominator. Because here we're dividing the same quantity, 3. 3 divided by 12, of course, is going to be larger than 3 divided by 15 because the denominator is smaller. That's all. That's all it is. We don't actually have to do any calculation. We don't have to do any computation. Do you understand? The answer is A. The answer is A. I'll see you tomorrow, okay? Bye now.